Imagine a place where whole people groups live as slaves to a rival tribe. Imagine facing the 60% chance you will bury a child before they reach the age of 5. Imagine living and dying with no knowledge of a God who loves you. Imagine being cursed and rejected by your family and friends for turning away from the spiritism of your life with no purpose and death with no hope. For over 5 million people in the Republic of Congo, it's not imagination, but reality, and it is all they have ever known. Though billions of dollars of foreign aid have been poured into the Congo, it has only highlighted the fact that true hope is not found in a program, but in a person. My name is Caleb Caviness, and God has called me to bring the glorious hope of the gospel to the Republic of Congo. Though several missionaries have gone to neighboring countries like Cameroon and the Democratic Republic of Congo, the Republic of Congo has been without a single long-term Baptist missionary for over 25 years. It has truly become a forgotten field. In the fall of 2016, God opened the door for me to spend several months in the Republic of Congo. For the time that I was there, I rented a small room on the property of a hospital in the jungle town of Mfondo. I used this opportunity to begin learning Lingala, which is the heart language of many of the Congolese people. One evening, just after dark, a man and woman rushed into the hospital carrying their 3-year-old daughter. She had a severe case of malaria, and she was dying. As I walked toward the small building that served as an emergency room, I heard the mother begin to wail and saw the father walk out of the room sobbing. He slumped to the ground and put his head in his hands, and I knew that he had just lost his little girl. As he sat on the small sidewalk by himself, I sat next to him searching for something to say, something that might shine a small light into the blackness that surrounded him. In broken Lingala, I pieced together the only phrases I could think of. I am so sorry. Yesu amwana nampasi na yo. Jesus sees your pain. Yesu alingi yo. Jesus loves you. As I said this, the man slowly lifted his head and looked at me through his despair and asked, Nani Yesu? Who is Jesus? For every soul seeking hope, for every person seeking comfort, my desire, my burden, my mission is to bring the answer to that question. Who is Jesus?
Souls to save, send the light, send the light, send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore, send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining in to watch our conversation with a missionary this Monday night, August the 31st, 2020. We're glad to be joined tonight by Brother Caleb and Kelsey Caviness. They're still newlyweds, I guess, and not been married long. They've had their first child just on July the 16th, a baby boy, and we're happy for them and want you to get to know them tonight and start praying for them as they prepare for what God has called them to do. Joining us as well on the screen is Brother Abair, and he's there to watch for your questions on YouTube and Facebook. And so we want you to send in some questions that maybe we can ask the missionaries tonight. Thanks for taking time to join us, Brother Caleb and Kelsey. Why don't you start by telling us just briefly, some people would have seen it on Sunday in your testimony and so on, but tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, and how you came to know the Lord. Would you do that?
Yes, sir. I had the privilege of growing up in a pastor's home, and I'm the youngest of five kids. And so from my earliest memory, I grew up going to church with my dad, and then I started going soul winning with my dad, and he would put me in a pack on his back, and we'd go for it. And I just got to grow up in ministry. But at the age of five, every year my family did a thing we called spiritual birthdays. And on the date that one of my siblings or my parents had gotten saved, we would have a birthday party for them for the day that they had a spiritual birth. And it was October 16th, and I was 5 years old, and my sister had just had her spiritual birthday party. And I remember standing there, and I'd been talking to my dad about it for a while, but I remember standing there after her spiritual birthday party and thinking, you know, she's just told about how she knows for sure if she died, she'd go to heaven, and how Jesus had already forgiven her for her sins and paid for those. And I remember standing in my living room thinking, I can't say that for myself, and just feeling the conviction of that. And I asked my dad that night if I could get saved, and he took me into our living room, and me and my dad and mom knelt at our couch in our living room in Winston, Oregon, and I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. So.
Kelsey, how did you get saved?
I was actually the same age as he was. I was 5 years old, little girl, and my dad led me to the Lord in my bedroom. So,
yeah. And praise the Lord. I was 5 years old as well when I trusted Christ as my Savior. And, you know, it is a blessing for sure to have grown up in a Christian home, have a godly heritage, something I'm surely thankful for. And I'm sure I heard the gospel many times as a little child, but I remember the night too when I trusted the Lord as my Savior. And that's a great blessing, great privilege. So tell us your story. Brother Caleb, obviously you were in Bible college, I think, and you had graduated and all that. You've said on Sunday that you had started deputation and you didn't have a wife. So you're praying for a wife.
I was. So
we can hear both sides of the story if it doesn't agree, but I want you to tell us how you two met, you know, fell in love and you know, joined in marriage and so on.
So, I mean, anyone who knew me at all growing up knew that I was going to the mission field. And so I graduated college, and, you know, I really been praying about timing for what God wanted for me. And, you know, you start getting that pressure as you get towards a senior year of college and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And you're not married yet. And then pastors are asking you, you know, are you courting, or you have anybody in mind, and you don't really, and you start feeling that pressure. But I decided, I spent a summer with some good missionary friends in Uganda. And one of the things that I spent a lot of times talking to them, and I made a decision when I was a sophomore in college, after talking to those missionaries and listening to some of the heartbreaks and some of the problems that had come up in missions between spouses. And I made a decision in sophomore year of college that I would rather spend my life not married than married to the wrong person. And so I really just prayed that God would give me the patience to wait for the right person. And so as I graduated college in 2016, I immediately headed off to Congo. And we have a little country church in a logging town in Oregon. Once I came out of college, I didn't think I had any options back home. I mean, we are one of those little churches where, you know, you're in your youth group, there's four girls and three of them are your sisters. You know, it's that type of thing. And, you know, you didn't figure you had a whole lot of options back there, but I knew, I didn't want to step outside of God's will for my life to look for God's will for my life. And so I went to Congo. I knew that's the next step God had for me. And when I came back after a 3-month trip in Congo, my first Sunday back was actually my first Sunday to meet my wife-to-be, because her family had joined our church and had started coming to our church. They'd come from a church of like faith a few hours away. And they had joined our church. And so when I came back, I'd met her. And, you know, at when you first meet someone, my focus wasn't on, oh, I'm going to marry this person. It was just, you know, oh, there's a new family in our church. And I was kind of focused on my ministry. But as the summer came and we got to know each other, and then really started getting interested as we went to a youth camp together, and I was leading the group and she was one of the lady counselors, and getting to know her better through that. And during that week of camp is when I thought, you know what, I want to get to know her better. And unfortunately, that camp ended on Friday night. And on Saturday morning, I drove from Oregon to Texas for 9 months of linguistic and advanced missionary training in Texas. And so it kind of made it so that immediate courtship wasn't able to start right away. But I started getting in touch with her and talking to her dad, and that we were able to start long distance. And God just started knitting our hearts together, and we started FaceTiming, and then I got to come home, and it took me about a year, but I pulled the wool over her eyes and got her to say yes. So I was real excited about that.
Anything you agree with the whole story, Kelsey?
He's telling the truth. Yes.
Telling the truth.
Yes. On our first date, we did a phone call because he was in Texas. So we each just took a walk and talked on the phone to each other. And after I got the phone, I said, if the Lord allows, I would marry him today. So I was ready to marry him pretty short off the bat.
She didn't tell me that.
I didn't.
Now, Kelsey, I think you know, he talked about nursing, you being involved in nursing. So had you gone to school for nursing?
Yes. Yes. I graduated 5 years ago.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I was going to make some wisecrack about your age then. Are you older than, are you rocking the cradle? Are you older?
No. Just shy of 2 years. Just, I'm older.
Yeah. It's because I'm so mature. You know, yeah. I have to find someone who could
match. That can take care of you.
You know. That's
the word. Some of our young people have been sending in some questions already. And my daughter was asking about medical procedures from the time that you spent in Congo. They probably just want to hear you tell more stories of that, if you got anything to share. So they want to know about medical procedures and things that you were involved in there.
Okay. So for those of y'all who weren't at the youth conference and hadn't heard some of those stories already, you know, when our door into Congo is through a hospital, and they're getting our visas for us. And so my first trip, I flew over there, and you know, I'd never met, other than just emailing, I'd never been in contact with anyone over there before. So I kind of flew there sight unseen by myself as a 21-year-old. I turned 22 about 3 weeks after I got there. So here I am showing up in Congo at this hospital, and the doctor had said, you know, I want you to be my personal assistant. And so, you know, I thought that was going to be office work and paperwork and things like that. And he had other ideas. And so it wasn't long before he asked if I wanted to watch a surgery. And long as he went through things, and, I got to be a part of over 40 surgeries those first 3 months that I was there, and not just watching them, but assisting on them and kind of diving in full bore. So for specific stories about that, man, I could go on for, I don't know how long. I mean, I remember the first time, it was the middle of the night, we're in this little operating room, and we're in the middle of surgery, as emergency surgery, and the generator runs out of diesel, and all the lights shut out, everything goes pitch black, and we're standing there, so nobody move, you know, they're scrambling for a cell phone flashlight, and you know, that's not something that you expect to happen in an operating room, but just things like that. And there's all sorts of fun things. There's a book a lot of missionaries use called Where There Is No Doctor. And it's a book where a lot of missionaries will go through and reference, you know, if you can't get to a hospital, here's what you do in these situations. There's a second book to that called Where There Is No Dentist. And I remember a motorcycle accident or a multiple vehicle accident coming in. There was a bunch of people. And I remember that doctor that I was working with running by me and throwing that book, Where There's No Dentist, at me and pointing at one of the operating rooms and saying, why are that guy's jaw shut? And it was broken here, 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 and there in four places. And I remember just grabbing the book, flipping it open, saying, okay, let's see. All right, let's grab the wire and go to town. And it was a lot of really unique experiences, from getting to help deliver babies and C-sections to, I always liked broken bones. I did construction all through high school and college. So lining things up and slapping the screws in and putting metal plates on and all that kind of stuff, that made sense to me. But it was really really neat, because when I came back from Congo after that first trip, one of the first things we connected on was the medical, because she was working in a hospital as a nurse, and she was working, and we got to talking about, she was a little bit jealous because she was talking about how long it would take her in school and different things to be able to do some of the things that I had the opportunity to do with no training at all. And so it was really neat how God arranged things in his timing.
One of our men asked a question about, you know, your experience or your training or your credentials now. Had you ever taken a first aid course or anything before you became a hospital assistant?
Yes, I have taken some first aid courses, but you know, it's base level, you know, survival first aid, what to do in an emergency, CPR, that type of thing. It was not surgery, for sure. And it definitely wasn't delivering babies. I came back as a 22-year-old, and you know, my sisters were about to have their babies, and you know, I'm asking them very detailed questions. And you know, one of my sisters had to have a C-section, and I'm, you know, I just done several of those, and so I'm asking questions about what they're gonna do and things like that. And she said, "It's a little bit weird that you know about this." You know, I agree, but it's. Over there, it's one of those things where the doctor said, you know, I need the hands. So if you're willing, I'll use you. And so, you know.
I'm sure it was strange, for sure. But it's an opportunity that God gave you, right? In your door into the country. So praise the Lord for that. I want Brother Abert to ask you some questions about deputation and that sort of thing.
Yes, one of our teenagers is asking, how long have you been on deputation and how much support you currently have raised?
So we've been on deputation for just about 2 years now. And we are at about 85% support. We were on pace to be done in June before everything happened. And so we're praying we'll be able to finish up here soon and get to language school. That's our next step.
Excellent. Well, speaking of language school, do you... when do you plan to be in France? I mean, obviously things have been switched around quite a bit, but do you have maybe an idea of when you'll be there and studying language?
So France just started just over a week ago. They just started issuing student visas again. And those are the only visas I know of as from America, from the United States of America, that you can get to go to France as a student visa. So that was a huge answer to prayer. We've been praying for months. There was no way to go to language school, even if we wanted to. And so right now we're looking at two start dates. One is in January and the other is in May. And we're looking right now to with the language school. There's a few things with visas and with also the language school. They cap their classes at they like to have their classes about 10 students, and they cap them at 16. And so we're working to see which class we'll get accepted to. But Lord willing, we'll be there at the latest by May of this coming year.
And your purpose in going to France was, you know, to learn the French language. You know, I've read that there's two official languages in the Republic of Congo.
Yes, sir.
Your purpose in going to France, obviously, is to learn French, right? But the other language, how do you say it? Elanga? No.
Lingala.
Lingala. Yes, Lingala. Do you already have a certain level of proficiency in that language?
So I can get around. I'm conversational in Lingala. I took lessons while I was there. I hired a high school teacher who would come over a couple days a week and come teach me Lingala while I was there. And then part of it was just, you know, if you have 3 months, my whole first week in the country, I was around I hadn't met anyone who spoke English my first week in the country trying to get up to the hospital. So there's days where you learn the word nini, which is what, and you go to the market with a notebook and you start pointing at things and just asking what and get names. So I can get around. This last time we were both in Congo together, we had to travel by Land Rover 3 days each way to get to the hospital from the capital where we flew into the hospital. And it was my job to negotiate for our food and for our lodging and transport ferries across rivers and things like that. So I can get around in Lingala, and we'll be learning a lot more once we get there permanently. But the thing for French is all of our registration, our things with the government, leasing buildings or renting buildings, all of the legal forms, the business, everything like that has to happen in French in the capital city. So it's really important that we get a good handle on that, so that we're not only able to communicate well, but also we're not getting ourselves in trouble trying to get religious registration set up and a church started without a really firm grasp of what are these documents that we're signing, and not miscommunicating with the government officials that we need to talk to.
Sure. Is there things you can even be doing online right now to be learning Lingala, or will you get a tutor when you get there eventually, or what's the plan?
So it'll be a little bit of both. We'll get a tutor once we get there. And a lot of the Lingala, we'll not only learn from a tutor, we'll use that predominantly. If as much as we can, we'll use that even more than French. If you're white and you come to Congo, it's a rarity. And usually it's only French people or Europeans that are going down as tourists in Congo. And so if you're white, the Congolese people expect you to speak French. And if you know any Lingala at all, it's a huge opportunity to them. You just see them light up. You know, if they look at you, you know, bonsoir, and you say, oh, mbote, sangonini, and you start talking to them in their language, you just see them light up and they get so excited that you would speak Lingala. So we'll definitely be working on that. I do have a Lingala book from some of the doctors that were there at that hospital. And they wouldn't give me the book or let me buy it from them, but they did let me take a picture of every page. So it was about 200 pages. And I sat one evening and took a picture with my phone of every single page. So I do have that. And so that's helpful as well.
I'm Pastor Brian Johnston from Gospel Light Baptist Church in Richmond Hill. We're just on the north side of Toronto, and we're getting to have a conversation tonight with Brother Caleb and Kelsey Caviness, missionaries going to the Republic of Congo. I want you to tell us more about the Congo. Obviously, I don't think anybody in our church right now, you know, has been to the Congo. We have a few folks that came to our church pre-COVID. We're still having struggling getting back meeting again, but pre-COVID, you know, we do have some folks in our church from Nigeria. We've had folks come from Zimbabwe and, you know, a few African countries, but never been to the Congo. You know, our folks won't be familiar with things. So just tell us things about the Republic of Congo and things that might help us to get to know the country, the culture, the people. Just share as much as you can.
All right. So the first thing that you'll have to know, and we get this all the time on the road, is if you just jump on your computer and Google Congo, you're not going to be looking at the country that we're going to. There are two Congos. They're right next to each other. There's a Republic of Congo and a Democratic Republic of Congo. And they're right next to each other. And the Democratic Republic of Congo is right in the center of Africa. And it is our neighbor. We won't be going to that Congo. And generally, that's what, if you're going to read about Congo, that's the one you're reading about. It's a much bigger country. The country we're going to is about 6 million people. And 70% of those 6 million people are concentrated in the bottom third of the country. And the top two thirds of the country are mostly very, very dense rainforest. And throughout that rainforest, the other one third of the population are spread through there in small tribes and pygmy villages. And it's much of that northern part of the country is very much of a logging and agrarian and fishing are the primary things they do up there. So a lot of people, I think when they picture Congo, their thought is kind of African savanna and lions and giraffes walking across. And that's actually not what Congo looks like. That's East Africa. Congo is very, the southern part, you have rolling hills and grasslands. But once you get about halfway up through the northern part of the country, it is some of the most dense rainforest in Africa. And there's gorillas and forest elephant and chimpanzees and all that kind of stuff. But it's very, very thick jungle. In fact, when you're driving down the road in Congo, and you're driving through jungle, you can drive for hours without ever seeing a trail or a path or any way to get into the jungle. It's just grown together so thick. And it's really amazing like that. The people are very friendly. They are usually a little bit confused as to why someone from a country like the United States that's so, in their view, rich and prosperous, why we'd want to be in Congo. And it's really a great opportunity to get to explain to them that, you know, we're there for something so much better than money. And we would leave every penny we have ever had for them to have something so much more important than money. But they're very friendly people. Since 2003, Congo's been at peace. There was a lot of civil war and things like that before that. But we don't feel unsafe in the country, although there are some areas. And like a lot of countries in sub-Saharan Africa, it's safe until it's not. And it can turn very quickly. But the times that we've been there, I haven't felt at risk from people or anything like that. The biggest things you have to deal with are the diseases and the insects. And so malaria is definitely one of the things you'll deal with daily. But the people, they love to sing. They love that you get a big smile from them. We're white, and so we're Mandele. As you walk down the street or drive past, you hear Mandele, Mandele. You know, they're pointing, and you know, little kids will run up. I've had little kids run up to me and rub my hand to see if the white would rub off. It didn't. But they just, you know, it's really a lot of fun. It's really, they can be very hard workers. They love to sing. And one of the things I love about being there is just, you'll see groups of guys, you know, 25 years old, walking down the side of the road, carrying a big bundle of bananas that they've cut out of the jungle or rolling a wheelbarrow. And they're just working and they're just singing at the top of their lungs, walking down the road. And that's a really fun part of Congolese culture that I've enjoyed so much, is how they sing and how well they sing. And so the average Congolese family is very, very poor on a Western standard. And, you know, I think only 7% of the homes in the entire country are wired for electricity. And most families will live most of their lives on what they grow. So it's your average family, even in a town, you know, you'll have a family of four or five or six people that are living in 1 to 200 square feet of mud brick walls and tin roof, if they can afford it or not. You get the palm frond roof that they'll make the thatch roof for themselves. And then in the middle of the city, you'll get some nicer buildings, and usually the people that have connections with oil or the government or the president's family and things like that have much nicer houses. But the average person, even a middle class person in Congo, wouldn't have what we would consider consistent electricity or electricity at all, and things like that.
Tell me about things to do with sickness and disease and maybe a short lifespan for people in the Congo typically.
So generally, more than anything else that we see over there is malaria. And it is not just prevalent, it's devastating. When I'm working at the hospital, it was a almost daily occurrence to have parents come in with a 1 to 3 year old child who's just having a seizure and completely unresponsive, and immediately trying to get them on the right medications and a blood transfusion and things like that. And infant mortality there is so high because of a lot of these diseases, because of malnutrition and things like that. And then also because of a lost state, you know, you bring the gospel to a country and tell them, you know, the gospel isn't just about making your life better, but the gospel does make your life better. And it's not just about making your life on this earth better. But, you know, polygamy is legal and practiced in Congo, and that effect on the family and that effect on the children, you see that affecting lifespans, and you see that going into short, a lot of infant mortality because, you know, they're taking care of one family but not another, or you have rival wives who are, you know, who are attacking other wives' children and things like that. For us, one of the things we'll work to do is just to protect ourselves from malaria, you know, normal precautions, mosquito netting. There are some medications that we can take. There's definitely challenges with that. Some of the medications taken long-term, I feel like they might be worse than malaria. But, you know, just trying to be wise. And thankfully, there are some people there that we know that have been there long enough at that hospital, who they pretty much have that figured out and can help us with staying healthy ourselves. One of the things that we hope to do in the future is with the medical experience that we've been able to gain from the hospital and my wife's nursing experience, is to be able to just set up a basic medical clinic and use that as an opportunity to reach people for the gospel and to open doors into villages. And we've seen several good missionaries in other neighboring countries that have done that. And it's been a huge opportunity to open doors. And even something as simple as a prenatal clinic with minimal medication, just some prenatal vitamins and a stethoscope and a little Doppler to get heart rate. You could have just a crowd of women there every day who would not only be there and be so thankful for you, but have an opening to give the gospel. And so that's something that we hope to be able to take advantage of once we get there.
Brother Abraham, I'm going to have you go ahead and ask a couple questions this time, if you would.
Okay. Brother, can you tell us what are your goals or your plans for the ministry in the Congo when you guys do get there?
Yes, sir. So once we get there, our first goal, and I'm really trying, I think it's easy to be excited about getting there, and we are, but I'm trying to set realistic goals. I'm trying not to be the missionary that says, oh, in my first term, we're going to have 6 churches and a Bible college and an orphanage and sending missionaries to other countries. Our first goal is to get in and get what's a religious registration set up. And what that essentially does for us is it allows us to get our own visas for ourselves and stay long-term in the country. Right now, the hospital is the one getting a visa for us. And they've agreed to invite us in and get us the sponsorship we need to get into Congo. But once we get in there and we get the process done to get a religious registration, then the government views that religious registration, the government then views that as a Congolese church that can invite us in as many times as it wants to. And so that is our first goal, is to get in, get settled, start working on the language, on Lingala as well, and then as quickly as possible get that religious registration done. That does two main things for us. It lets us keep ourselves in the country permanently, and that lets us invite other missionaries and people who would want to come on a missionary trip to come work with us, things like that. It will let us open the doors for other people to come in and get those missionaries into the country under that registration, which is big for help, because we need as much help as we can get. And we're really praying God will send more missionaries to Republic of Congo, but also for supplies. The ability to, you can't really do UPS to Congo or FedEx or things like that. And shipping and things like that is very, very intensive. And really, a lot of times it just doesn't get there. And so the ability to have someone fly over with some things and supplies that we need would be a huge, huge benefit. So that's our first step. Once we are getting established and getting starting to get settled in that language and with that religious registration, part of what comes in with getting religious registration is getting a building, whether it be whatever house that we end up renting or place, having a place to meet there, or a separate place to meet. and start with just a group of people meeting. And it doesn't have to be a big group. It could be three people, but a group of people meeting, that's one of the requirements to get the religious registration. And so really trying to take that small group and work them into a Bible study and really start teaching them. And I know this seems rudimentary, but one of the big goals is to get there and start making building relationships and connections and giving the gospel. And it's a different step to give the gospel with a lot of people in Congo. A lot of people in our culture, I can walk up and ask, do you know what Jesus Christ has done for you? Or, I wanted to tell you today that God loves you. And can I tell you what he's done for us? In Congo, that's a little bit complicated because they don't have the base understanding of who I'm talking about when I'm talking about God or Jesus. As you might have seen from the video, some people will have a bit of a Catholic influence from France. But a lot of people who have their tribal influence, the word that's been translated God in Lingala is Nzambe. And we get our English word zombie from the Lingala word for God. And it literally means the chief of the dead. So for some people, they don't want his attention. They don't, if you say Zambi Alingiyo, God loves you, that's not a good thing. And so we'll be doing a lot of training from the ground up where we're explaining as they view in their religious mindset of their appeasing spirits. And there's all sorts of different spirits, and there's evil spirits and there's powerful spirits. We get to go in and talk to them, not about the spirits that they know, but the one that created them, the one that made everything that is, and what is he like, and how can you know him, and why don't you feel close to him, and what has sin done in our life, and what is sin? So we're excited to get to start with people from the beginning, from before creation, and explain to them who God is and start working with them, because our goal isn't to get people to pray a prayer, even to pray a prayer in Jesus' name if they don't know who Jesus is. We want them to truly know what they're praying and understand and have a true repentance and calling on God for salvation, not just going to the other spirit, because that spirit is powerful. And so that's our main goal once we get there.
Amen. Makes sense. And it's so important. I've seen things before from New Tribes Missions, and I've even used some of their material before here in teaching people that just had no background with the Bible, no understanding of truth. And we have to do that. And even truthfully, in North America, we're seeing more and more biblical literacy. People don't know the scriptures. And so it's vital for people to really learn the truth of God's word from the beginning. Right. And so that's good to hear. Brother Avery, you got a couple more questions maybe?
Yes. Are there other languages spoken like in the tribal dialects, or is it, bilingual pretty much across the board there?
Definitely there are, I believe, 54 other languages spoken in the country. But one of the blessings for us is that there are, outside of French, in the actual tribal languages, there are two primary tribal languages that are trade languages. And so the average person I meet in Congo is usually at least trilingual. And so a lot of people, what happens is they have their small group and their small tribal group, and they have their own tribal language, but they also teach Lingala or one of the other tribal language, one of the other two tribal languages from birth. And so if you know Lingala and French, you can reach, my guess would be 70 to 80% of the country with those two languages. And if you learn one other language, you're going to reach the majority of the other 20%. Now, there are some tribal groups. I've had the opportunity to be up with some of the Aka groups, the pygmy groups, way up in the northern part of the country. Their language is not only do they a lot of them only know that language. It's an unwritten language. So that's something where, you've got, I believe over 20,000 of them in the country with no written language. And obviously because of that, no Bible, no literacy. I remember standing out in the middle of the jungle in one of these little villages, And the hospital had sent out a group from American Leprosy Mission to take photographs of some of these people that had leprosy. And they had the one man had to sign a consent form. And I remember standing there with a man who was probably in his late 20s, early 30s. And they asked him to make a mark on a piece of paper. And I remember him standing there and his hand was just shaking. And he made this little squiggle. And he looked up, tears in his eyes, this huge smile. And because it was the first time he had ever written anything. And it was also, everyone was standing around looking at him. You know, that mark meant him. And he had never written down his name. And it was a really neat thing to see. But for our language, French and Lingala will get us to the majority of people that we need to reach.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, that's great, brother. Can you tell us also where you will start your ministry? Or where do you think you'll start?
We're planning to start our ministry right in the capital city of Brazzaville. It's a city of right around 1 million people. And it is a huge opportunity. And there's, as far as we've been able to find, there's no one else working there that's of like faith. And it also allows us, the offices that we will be working with for our religious registration and our visas and everything like that are right there in Brazzaville in the capital city. And so we're planning on starting, getting a base right there in the capital and seeing what God will do with there. And as our ministry progresses, we'd love to spread out into the villages and other places. But we're trying to start right in the hub and work out from there.
Amen. Well, a lighter question is just someone wants to know, what is your favorite Congolese food?
Oh. My wife said bananas.
Very good.
She likes kwanga, which is, it's a cassava root. It's kind of similar to a potato, and they grind it up and then they make these lumps of stuff called kwanga. It's white. They wrap it in banana leaves and tie it up, and you can buy it really cheap, and it tastes like pretty much nothing, but it has kind of the consistency of sticky rice. And so she likes that a lot. I like some of their, antelope is good. They call it antelope, is good. The fish, some of their fish, electric catfish, it's delicious. Their Goliath tiger fish is so, so good. And that's kind of the 5-foot-long, 100-pound version of a piranha. And so if you want to see an amazing fish, look up the Goliath tiger fish, but it's delicious. Those are some of my favorite things to eat.
We've heard of cassava several times in talking to different missionaries around the world. And it seems like it's a common thing in different cultures. Even our Filipino people here, that's something that they enjoy as well. And people maybe do things in different ways with it, whatever, but right. That's great. Brother Avery, you got a couple more questions?
I do, yes. Can you tell us about their form of government and how it might differ from, the West and things like
that? Definitely. So they have a president, and they have elections. And I met some of the men who actually have run against the president when I visited one of the prisons. And so it's open elections that if you gain traction, you get thrown in jail. So it's pretty much the president has been in power longer than I think any other African leader, or one of them. He's been in power since the 90s. And it's one of those things where, in my opinion, he'll probably be the president until he dies. And then they'll probably go into war. There's a lot of corruption. And while they have open elections, it's a good way to get imprisoned if you run against the president. And so that's kind of there's a lot of corruption. There's a lot of bribery and a lot of that kind of stuff going on in the government. But the one good thing for the president is that he has kept things fairly stable since 2003. and there hasn't been a lot of unrest. There's still some areas of the country that are in opposition to him, but unlike a lot of countries around us, they're not in war every few years. The country, once they got their independence from France in 1960, they set up a kind of a communist state with the help of the Soviet Union. And so a lot of that, those policies still are in effect. And while after their civil war, they're no longer a Soviet communist state in their structure and their name, a lot of those policies are still in effect and still kind of temper how the government runs things. And they have a lot of that style of government still set up, even to the point where the hospital has a radio station, and they were trying to play some missionary stories in French from missionaries back in Eastern Bloc countries that were being persecuted under the Soviet Union. And the government came in and shut them down and basically said, you know, we don't talk bad about our older brothers in that sense, and said, you know, you can play things on the radio, but don't play anything that would make show them in a bad light. So there's still a lot of that undercurrent in the government and in policy.
Amen. Really, can you tell us just some of the hindrances or opposition that you know of or expect you'll face when you get there and trying to preach the gospel to the people there?
Definitely. One of the first hindrances that I believe we'll face is other religions, and in two ways. There will be the cults have started to get a strong foothold in Congo, and so they can be very they have a lot of opposition to anything else. And so there can be some challenges with that. But I think one of the biggest challenges that we'll face is that the Congolese churches believe that they're exactly like us. And they don't feel like doctrine really makes much of a difference. As long as you would talk about Jesus. And a lot of them are very works-based. It's really, I would say, prosperity gospel, but it's really just prosperity. There's not much gospel involved at all. And, you know, I've sat in many of the Congolese churches, and what I consistently hear is, if you follow Jesus, you'll have a good life. You follow Jesus, you'll have, and they don't explain how you follow Jesus in the sense of the need for salvation and that type of thing. It's just, if you come to the church, a lot of the Congolese churches have membership dues. So all members in good standing will pay X amount. I have a lot of pastors have really liked that. And, you know, the church in this city is having its anniversary. All members in good standing will pay X amount to fund this celebration for that. And, oh, we need to do this. All members. And if you don't pay your membership due, you're not a member in good standing. You can't partake of the Lord's Supper, which in most of those churches is, you know, they're doing alcohol and it's kind of sacrament more than what we would think of as communion. And so it's the challenge with that is you can get people who want to be religious, but it's a political thing. The position of pastor in Congo is more political than it is religious. And so that is definitely going to be a challenge, especially as an American. They automatically assume that you're wealthy. They assume that if they're going to be trying to train up men who are in it for the gospel's sake and for Christ's sake, and trying to find men that are there not for a position or a place of respect, but are there for the ministry itself, I think will be a huge challenge. Not that there aren't good men, but there's such a draw in that culture to place yourself in a position of success. And they view a pastor and ministry as an opportunity for that. And so I think that will be a big challenge once we get there.
Again, I'm Brother Johnston, Gospelite Baptist Church in Richmond Hill, Ontario, and we've got to chat tonight with Brother Caviness, who is my brother in Christ, amen? And he's a missionary on his way to the Republic of Congo. The Lord has given him a good wife. The Lord has given him a son. His son was born July 16th. What's your son's name?
Micah.
Micah. And praise the Lord for a son, a child. And so they're adjusting to a new life as parents and so on. And we need to pray for them as parents and training up children to live for the Lord and pray for their adjustments in coming days. Again, they're hoping to either in January or May of next year be in France to go to language school there. French is one of the languages, he said, they need to learn to be effective and be able to minister and deal with people in the Congo. And so pray for that. And then also as they learn Lingala, a second language that is very important and vital to their ministry in the Congo, pray for them in these areas. Pray as they try to learn languages that God would give them a great understanding and ability to learn languages for both him and his wife. I want you to have a part in praying for them. I want you to have a part in giving and supporting their family. Those of you that were in church Sunday morning, you got to see a video of him testifying about their ministry and what God has called them to. This Thursday night, we'd love for you to watch. Our midweek service is going to be him preaching. I've gotten a video of him preaching in his home church, and we're going to show that this Thursday night for our service. And so I want to encourage folks to be watching that Thursday night. We'd like to send them an offering. I'm glad that they were willing to partake in this Zoom conversation with us tonight. They were supposed to come to our church back in April, but that, of course, was canceled with COVID-19, if you've not heard of COVID and so on. And that was, you know, that's obviously affected all of our lives in a big way. And I was disappointed they could not come, but decided to still try to get them online with us. And that this might be our opportunity to get them into our church before they head off to France and then ultimately to the Republic of Congo. So this week, I'd like you to give a special offering. You can send an e-transfer to donate at glbcyorkregion.com, or you could, you know, mail a check or bring an offering to church next Sunday. But I'd like you to give a special offering that we can help send to them, and just thanking them really for participating with us this week. I want you to continue on, folks, in our church. Let's be faithful in our giving. We love missionaries. We want to support as many missionaries as we possibly can. And I know the coronavirus hasn't been a great time for church attendance and church growth and all kinds of things. But folks, we've got to keep on giving. We've got to keep on praying for our missionaries and doing more for Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ is going to come back. And we don't know when it's going to be, but I believe it's going to be in our lifetime. And I think we need to do all we can to get as many missionaries and church planters around the world as we can. So I'd love to support this family in the future. And I want you to be praying for them and giving towards that end. It's been hard to challenge people. It's been hard to have normal missions emphasis days and challenge people. Let's do more for missions. Let's give more. But I'm asking you, please pray about what you can do to increase your faith promise giving and do more for the cause of missions so we can send out more missionaries around the world. So have a part in that. Please send an offering this week, specifically for the Caviness family, or bring something next Sunday if you can, mail something, and that would be a blessing. We're going to close, but Brother Caviness, I'd like you just to, as we close, maybe share with us, the people, your passion for missions in the Congo, and then any prayer requests that you might have.
Well, for us, what we are so excited about seeing, and we're just praying that God would allow, is we are so excited to see God cracking open a door to a country that's been closed for so long, for a country that for a lot of missions has been forgotten for so long. And it's been decades since there's been a long-term church planting Baptist missionary working there. And so it's our prayer and it's our desire and really it's our goal to not only go and to plow. And I wish I could sit here and promise that, you know, in 4 years or in 8 years, I could come back to y'all and show hundreds and thousands of people that have gotten saved or churches. And I can't guarantee any of that. What I can guarantee is that we will go and we will be faithful and we will plow where God has placed us. And we're going to love those people with all of our hearts. And we're going to work as hard as we can until God takes us home or sends us to another place. But we have given our hearts to the Lord and to the people of that country. And we are so excited to get to the people of the Republic of Congo and to start getting to answer, if you saw the video earlier, getting to answer the question, who is Jesus? And we feel so privileged to get to spend our lives answering that question. And what a better life could you ask for than getting to go and live every single day, bringing people the light of the gospel and just introducing them to our best friend. And so we are so excited to get there. For prayer requests, first of all, if you would pray for us to be able to finish our deputation as quickly as possible. Like I said, we're praying to go to language school here in January or May. And Lord willing, we'd like to be fully supported when we leave for language school. One of the things that we've been really saving is to pay for language school. Living and going to school in Paris is not a cheap place to live. And so when we decided that's where we felt like God wanted us to go to language school, we started adding up housing and tuition. And for a year, it's about $35,000. And so we started saving, and the Lord has already provided over 22,000 of that. And so if you would pray that we'd be able to make the rest of that so we could have that saved before we get there, that would be a huge answer to prayer. If you would pray that God would give us wisdom and safety on the road as we're trying to pick up meetings in areas where we're able to pick up meetings and to have meetings in places. I have several good friends right now who are on deputation, who are just recovering from COVID. And my grandpa and grandma my grandpa was just speaking at a missions conference down in Texas and was just exposed and had to quarantine, and he's in his 80s. And so we're really praying that God would not only give us wisdom on what meetings to take and where to go, but also that he would give us safety, not just for ourselves and our newborn, but the last thing we would want to do is to infect a church or go somewhere and spread this. And so if you would pray for us to have wisdom for that. And then lastly, one of the things that's really, really not heavy on my heart, but it's very something I'm really praying about, is if you would pray that the Lord would continue to hold this door open as the hospital there in Congo is run by one doctor, and that he has MS and some health issues, but he's stuck it out there for 2.5 decades now. And we're praying that God would continue to give him strength and help, and that God, he's offered to get us into the country, and we're just praying that we'll be able to finish, get through our language school, and get there in time while that door is open. And if you would pray with us to that end, that would be a huge blessing. And we value your prayer so much. I'm sure you've heard it from a lot of missionaries that, you know, we appreciate support, but we are desperate for your prayer. And it's easy in a environment, in a church that's established, in a country that's modern and up to date, it's easy to kind of lose sight of the importance of prayer. But I can tell you, every single day I got up in Congo, and every single relationship and person that I talked to, I knew that God was orchestrating things, and I could sense the prayer of people back in other countries and in places that were praying for us. And so we value that so much.
Amen. There it is. You're not just hearing it from me, you're hearing it from him, right? He needs us to pray. And sure, want to encourage our folks to begin praying for their family and the things he mentioned, finishing deputation and safety and protection and in health, and pray for wisdom going through things and making decisions, and pray for language school, pray for God to provide their needs for that. Pray for the door to stay open to him in the Republic of Congo, the way it's been, you know, granted thus far. So please pray about that he can get in, get settled, get established, you know, get the government things that he needs to be able to help sponsor in others in the future the way he wants to. So please be praying about that. I really want you to watch Thursday night's folks. 7 o'clock on Thursday night, you'll get to hear him speak, share his testimony, and preach to us. Brother Caleb reminds me a lot of our friends, Neil Ray, who's in a restricted country. Maybe I shouldn't have said his name, but he reminds me of our dear friend with his passion and commitment for the Lord's work and his just desire to go and stay and accomplish something, you know, no matter what are the obstacles or opposition. And I appreciated that as I watched videos online and different things and tried to get to know him before inviting him to come. He never contacted me. That seems to happen a lot in our church. They don't contact me. I contacted them and wanted them to come, wanted them to be in our church. And just I love his spirit for the Lord's work, for missions and for the Congo. So let's be praying for them. Please watch on Thursday night. Have a part in giving a special offering this week. And that will be a blessing and a help. Thank you so much, Brother Caleb. And say thank you to your wife for joining us. Maybe she had to slip off to take care of Micah. But pray for them and their family, their new baby boy. And pray for God to give them many children if the Lord tarries. And raise up an army for the Lord. But we sure do. We love you. I can say that. I love you sincerely because for months I've been, my mind's been on you. I've been praying for you. And so glad that we could connect in this way this week. So thank you so much for taking time to join us tonight.
Thank you.
All right. God bless you. Bye-bye.